بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I really like presentations which happen after coffee breaks, because you know most of the people are still having their coffee, and people who are back, they are still in the coffee mood. So you know I can actually go and talk whatever I want, and nobody will mind. Yeah. So this is a very short presentation on open source security. There have been a lot of people before me, I think yesterday, who spoke a lot about open source and security. I'm going to talk about this topic in a slightly different way. I'll talk from both the sides. I'll talk how open source security is better, and I'll also talk a little bit about closed source proprietary security, because most people who talk about open source security, they only want to trash closed source security. So I'm going to talk from both the sides, depending on how much time I have. So who am I? I am a principal software engineer. I have been working with Red Hat product security for around 10-ish years now. I am a part of various upstream security projects. I have worked with Mozilla, WebKit, PHP, Python, LibreOffice, and a lot of other projects I probably don't remember as well. I work with the security team. I am responsible for working on those security flaws. I triage security flaws. I assign CVIDs, if you know what a CVID is. And I work with them in various capacities. I am a Fedora contributor for the last 8 to 10 years. I am an open source enthusiast. I normally go and talk about various technical topics at various conferences. So let's talk a little bit about security, and let's talk about open source security. So how many people in the room know what this symbol on the screen means? How many people have seen this symbol before this day? So this basically is a symbol for Heartbleed. And Heartbleed was a flaw which was found in OpenSSL. OpenSSL is a crypto library which is used on internet. So when you go to facebook.com, or you know, when you go to gmail.com, or when you go to your bank's website, or when you transfer money on the internet, and when you enter your username and password, the crypto library like OpenSSL is responsible for making sure that you know whatever username and password you enter, whatever credit card, debit card details you enter, they are secure, and you know they are securely transmitted through the internet. So Heartbleed was a flaw which was found in OpenSSL exactly 2 years back. And this flaw changed the way open source security works. And this flaw is very, very simple. So if I know that you know you have an account with omanbank.com, and I know that you know you have logged into omanbank.com website, what I can do is I can send a packet to Oman Bank's web server. And what Oman Bank's web server would basically do is it will send me a dump of all the username and passwords. Right? So this is a perfect security flaw. I send a packet to your bank's website. Your bank replies back to me with your credentials, your username, your password, your credit card, debit card number, your CCV number, and you know other details as well. So this was a perfect flaw. It's called Heartbleed. And you know, if you're not aware, you should probably Google. This was a perfect flaw which was found in OpenSSL. And it changed the way people looked at open source. It changed the way people looked at open source security. So now that you guys are scared and excited, you know, we should try to probably figure out why security is very important. So security is important to everyone. It's important to an enterprise. So if you are a bank, if you are an e-commerce website, if you are a .com website, if you are the New York Stock Exchange, if you are an individual which has a laptop with you, which has a mobile, which has a tablet, security is extremely important. And most of the things about security are about the data which you have. So if you are a bank, if you are a company which manufactures something, you really are concerned about the data which you have, right? So your customer database, you don't want people to know who your customers are. You don't want people to know what prices you have quoted to your customers. You don't want hackers to know confidential information about how you manufacture your cars, or, you know, how you manufacture whatever thing which you work on. So data is extremely, extremely important. And most of the attackers on the internet, they are after the data. So if you are an individual, your laptop probably has your personal photographs. It has your bank statement. It has your credit card or debit card statement. It also has the details about, you know, how much money you earn, how much money you spend. So all this data is extremely important. So be it an enterprise or be it an individual, your data is extremely important. A lot of companies also pay a lot of attention to market value as such. So I think there was someone yesterday who discussed about, you know, when a company's website gets compromised, the amount of financial penalty they have to pay is so high that, you know, probably in a couple of weeks or a couple of months they'll go out of business. So that is extremely important. Your resources can be used to attack other people as well. So last month I was in a conference and I spoke with this person who is supposed to be a security expert for IoT devices, and he was talking about, you know, how just a couple of months back, I think, web cameras were used. So IoT devices in web cameras who have chips who are IoT enabled, you know, these web cameras were basically compromised, and thousands and millions of web cameras were used to run a DOS attack, to run a DDoS attack, right? So when your resources get compromised, when your servers, when your laptops, when your mobile devices, when your IoT devices get compromised, these devices can be used to attack other people as well. Like, you know, we have seen this example in case of IoT devices. Staying out of news is very, very important. Nobody likes to figure out in the news saying that, you know, your website was attacked, you know. So it is very, very important to make sure that you stay out of bad news as well. So the initial fears about open source, you know, there are a lot of people, when people try to implement open source in their organization, and I've spoken with a lot of government agencies, and the biggest fear which they have is about security. And the person you see on the screen is Steve Ballmer. He is the CEO, I think the ex-CEO of Microsoft. And what he used to basically do, and the thing which you see in his hand, these are called jelly beans. And I'm not sure if they are very famous in Oman, but probably in US, you know, they talk a lot about these small sweets. And what Steve Ballmer used to do is, he used to go to conferences and he used to go to customer sites, and he used to take a packet of jelly beans with him, and he used to have two bowls, right? He used to have two glass bowls, and he one glass bowl was for open source and one glass bowl was for a Microsoft product, like, you know, say Microsoft, I think Windows XP was hot at that time. So, you know, one glass bowl for, say, Red Hat operating system, or, you know, some other open source, and one glass bowl for my Microsoft. And what he used to do is, he used to take one jelly bean, and he used to say, okay, this jelly bean is for so and so security flaw in Red Hat. And he used to drop the jelly bean in the bowl. And then he used to take one more jelly bean, and he used to say, this jelly bean is for so and so security flaw found in Windows XP. And, you know, he used to keep on doing that. And probably by after 100 or after 200, the bowl which represented open source was full, and the bowl which represented Windows XP was kind of, you know, it had only 10 or 12 jelly beans. And he used to basically tell people, he used to show, he used to raise both the bowls, and he used to tell people that, you know, see, my open source bowl is completely full of security flaws, and my closed source, my Windows XP bowl, is empty because it is more secure. So, you know, he used to do things like that. And we actually spoke with him, and we told him that when you drop one jelly bean, when you drop one jelly bean in a bowl for Microsoft Windows XP, that is one security advisory which may contain hundreds of flaws, right? So he is totally wrong. When you take one jelly bean, that one jelly bean represents one security advisory which may contain hundreds of flaws, right? So he stopped doing that for some time, because, you know, we spoke with him, and he stopped doing that, and then he started again, and then we spoke with him again, and he stopped doing that. So right now, most of the initial fears about open source security is done by people who, you know, who are closed source vendors, and they want to make sure that, you know, people don't buy. So I have had instances in which closed source vendors, they go to government agencies as well, and you know, they tell them that, you know, you should not buy open source because it is not secure, right? So I'm basically here. I'm going to talk about five things. I know we are a little bit short of time, so I'm going to talk about five myths about open source security, and I'm going to talk on both the sides. I'm going to talk on both the sides of the coin. I'm going to discuss the open source side as well as the closed source one. And depending on how much time we have, we'll see how much we can talk on each of these topics. So the first thing which normally people talk about is that open source software is more or less secure than proprietary. So there have been various studies which have been done on this. I have one person who has done his PhD, and he's trying to compare open source security with closed source security. And I don't want to discuss all the details right now. If you probably meet me after the talk, we can discuss if you want more details. And he drew certain conclusions. One conclusion which he drew was there is no empirical proof that open source security is less or more secure than closed source security. That is one conclusion which he drew. The second conclusion which he drew was that the code quality for both open source and closed source was almost the same. We have instances in which code for open source is very good and code for closed source is very bad, and we have had other instances as well. So there is no empirical proof that which of the code quality is good and which one of them is bad. In the end, he basically concluded that depending on what software you buy, how you install the software, how you configure the software, both of the security can be equally good or bad, right? So this goes slightly in the favor of open source, but I don't want to trash closed source as well. So both of the security can be slightly good or bad depending on what software you buy, how you configure, and how you install. This is normally used to sell open source. So this is a very common saying that many eyes make for secure code. And there are advantages and disadvantages to this as well. So I want to give you a very simple example that, an open source operating system like Ubuntu or Zelle is made up of different components. So there is a Linux kernel, and then there is Firefox, and there is GNOME, and there is KDE, and different software. So normally people say that, just because you can review code, it means that the software is more secure. But there is one point which I normally want to, which I normally put in front of people is that, all of us use the Linux operating system probably in this room. How many people have actually downloaded the kernel code? And how many people have actually seen if the kernel code is secure? Right, so probably I don't think any one of us has actually downloaded the kernel code, or any one of us actually has the ability or the qualification to actually look at the kernel code and to figure out how secure it was, or if it was backdoored or not. Some time back, I met this gentleman in a conference in Europe, and he basically has a theory which says that, and I don't support the theory, but he says that the OpenSSL library which is present in all Linux distributions. So his theory basically says that the OpenSSL library is backdoored by the NSA, and I don't actually support that. And I actually went back to him and I told him that if you feel that OpenSSL is backdoored by NSA, why don't you download OpenSSL? And why don't you look through the code? And why don't you try to figure it out yourself? And it seems that OpenSSL is so complicated. So if you have ever looked at OpenSSL code, it is so complicated. It is a combination of C and assembly and architecture and machine-specific code. You need to have a PhD in mathematics to actually understand what OpenSSL does. It is so complicated. So just because you can see the code, just because you can download the code, just because you can read the code, does not mean that you have the qualification or you can understand what the code does, right? But from a closed source point of view, at least you have the code, right? So if you want to really look at closed source code, you need to have a disassembler. So there are programs available which are called disassemblers, which can convert a binary into an assembly, or you can even convert a binary into C code. So if you really want to look at closed source code, you need to buy these disassemblers, and these disassemblers are extremely expensive. I know a couple of disassemblers which are like 5,000 USD or something like that. So if you really want to look at closed source code, you need to disassemble, and remember one thing, it is illegal. Yeah, I'm kind of short of time. And it is illegal to disassemble code as well. So just because you can look at code does not mean that it is more or less secure. And I'm going to kind of go a little bit fast because one more myth is bad people can look at source code, so it is less secure. This can be true and false as well. If bad people can look at your code, even good people can look at your code, they can find out what flaws are. And we have had instances in which flaws were discovered, patched, fixed, and given to customers in a couple of hours. So this is only something which open source can do. Anyone can contribute to the code, so it is all bad. This is one more myth. Just because people can contribute to code does not mean that it is all bad. There is a review process. So if you send a patch to a project, there is a review process. And you know, just because you send a patch does not mean it will be committed. Open source software does not mean that it is open source for your organization to use. So there are licensing issues as well. So just because you can write a patch does not mean that you know you can apply the patch in the software which you use. And so there is a new security world. So if you have not heard of this, there is Heartbleed, there is Shellshock. And if you have not heard of this, you should probably Google. It is extremely interesting. I don't have time to talk about all of them right now. So these are security flaws in open source products which affected a lot of the internet. And last but not least, before I conclude, what does all of this mean? So open source security is real, but that does not mean that everything out there is secure. Closed source evangelists, they try to trash open source security, but they are not totally correct. Very, very important, a chain is as weak as its, or a chain is as strong as its weakest link. So just because you install open source software does not mean that it is secure by default. I have had people whose root password is Red Hat. So if you use your root password as Red Hat, then that is definitely a bad thing to do you. You will definitely be hacked. Right? So just because you install open source does not mean that you are secure by default. You need to have a secure configuration. And last but not least, all software is written by humans. We are all prone to mistakes, right? So that is something which you need to remember. And that's probably my last slide. And if you have any questions, I don't think we have any time, but you know, you can meet me offline after the conference or after the talk, and you know, we can discuss if you want. Thank you. That was the fastest I have ever spoken.